Hello from Burbank in Southern California. We're here for a very good reason, to meet the man who, quite simply, for the past decade, has been the most popular movie star in the world, Clint Eastwood. Actually, his career didn't get off to a flying start. For 18 months, he worked at Universal up the road, and parts in pictures such as Tarantula and The First Traveling Sales Lady didn't draw his attention to anybody. But for 7.5 years, he was in the television series Rawhide as Rowdy Yates, and that made him a star. Then he traveled to the plains of Spain to make those three spaghetti westerns, beginning with A Fistful of Dollars, and the star became something of a legend. And Eastwood became known, as he is to this day and perhaps to his dying day and beyond, as the man with no name. But Eastwood is more than just a movie star. After the fiasco that attended the making of the movie Paint Your Wagon, his companies own pretty well all the movies he's made. And he's directed 8 of them, starting with distinction with Play Misty for Me, making 2 very good westerns, High Plains Drifter and The Outlaw Josie Wales, and coming right up to date, Firefox. It's the story of an audacious hijack of a Russian plane from under the nose of the Soviet Premier himself. Eastwood plays Mitchell Grant, a troubled Vietnam hero who doesn't really want to take on the job.
We need you, Major. We need you to fly again. Now, I know that's a tender area to broach with you. I've read your POW files. I know what the doctors say. I've seen you for myself. But I don't think that this...
Hold on. Hold on, will you? I'm not Air Force anymore. You go back there and tell them that.
This isn't Air Force, Major.
What, you want me to fly?
Yes. We want you to fly. We want you to fly the greatest warplane ever built.
As I said, we're here in downtown Burbank. We're just across the road from the Warner Brothers studios, where the Eastwood operation has its own mission control.
Although his office is on the studio lot, Eastwood, as in his films, remains a loner. Malpasso consists merely of a secretary and a friend who went to school with him. His personal style is low-key, no chauffeur, and he wears his sneakers to work. It's here that he goes through the scripts that are offered to him, and from among the thousands he chose Firefox, a novel written by a Welshman.
I've been looking for a very good suspense film for some time. I haven't, I guess since the Play Misty days, I haven't had a really one that I thought was very good. And I thought this had the combination of that, of everything. It had the combination of a very broad, high-style adventure, but it also it had the feelings or the element of a tight suspense film.
Many of the actors in Firefox are English. Warren Clark and Nigel Hawthorne and Freddie Jones are all very well known in England. How did you know about them?
They were all very well recommended. I had looked at tapes on a lot of them, and I met some of them. I never read actors because I can't bring myself to do that. I never liked it when I had to do it, and I can't bring myself to make somebody else go through it.
You say you don't like them to read, but when they're on the set, I mean, do you then tinker with their performance?
I'll tinker with it. That's no problem there once you're doing the film, but there's something about coming into an office and meeting somebody. Once you own the part as an actor, I'm speaking about other actors. Now, once you own the part, there's a certain relaxation sets in and a certain ability to hide behind the character or within the character. Bring the character within you, however you want to put it. Reading is a sort of a technique all its own, so I would rather see a performance and just see a half a scene or just something to see how a person handles themselves. But there's so many very, very fine actors in England that there's a great variety to choose from. I thought it was a great pleasure for me.
Yes, one last thing. We just learned this from Baranovich. There will be a recording device in the cockpit, a black box, I believe you Americans call it. It is voice activated. It was installed for one of their test pilots who would like you to use it. In the event that, well, if it should happen and we were somehow able to salvage the aircraft, it might be possible to reconstruct enough from your diary, as it were, to be helpful.
Sir?
Yes, 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 I'm coming. Well, Mr. Gant, I suppose this is the end of the road. Pratt. Let me rephrase that. Let's say the beginning.
Right.
As an actor, would you rather be directed by Clint Eastwood or by somebody else?
It depends on who the somebody else is. If it's somebody else that I respect the work, it's naturally easier to be directed by somebody else, though I've done 8 films as a that I've directed myself in, and it's when you know what you want, it isn't bad. If I'm working with somebody that I understand what they're trying to get, there's no real problem. It's much easier to have somebody else have the headache.
Yeah, but I've watched actors, major actors on films, who've needed to go to their caravan for a couple of hours to get in the mood of their part. If you're directing, you sacrifice that luxury, don't you?
You have to. You have about 10 seconds or less. But you don't... you stay in the character somewhat. You keep a little bit of it with you, but there's a switch that goes in your brain. And when the switch... It's time to step in front of the camera, then you throw another switch.
No, I was going to think, what I'd love to have done is brought him out in a separate shot, but we can do that another time when the train comes by, I guess.
Would you like to, should we have one more without the train?
It's 4 a.m. on a wet November night.
You got a strobe thing for this side, don't you?
Yeah.
Eastwood, in full costume and makeup, has to address himself to the camera angles, the lighting, and the staging of the scene, all part of the job of director.
You know.
Okay, print it.
Much of the ground action in Firefox takes place in Moscow, being played in this film by Vienna. It's been a favorite movie location since Carol Reed went there for The Third Man.
You bet. And then the fellow steps in on the right frame.
Yeah. Let him come around and step in on the right frame.
You bet.
And then we can do all kinds of shit.
When it comes to plotting a fight, few actors or directors have the experience of Eastwood. In the film, Russian dissidents help the American flee the KGB.
Short one is wondering what to do. Since there are four of us now. Right.
When he takes a swing at George, he'll grab me kind of around here.
Okay, I've got to let you stay in that right side of frame, so if you go out, you're going to go out.
Get in here, Otto. Get right in here, so
you're big.
Okay.
Mark.
Head mark.
Excuse me. Now, everybody step out of the light so we can look at
it. You catch yourself shaving? No, that's enough.
The scene is observed by a former Welsh schoolmaster, Craig Thomas. 5 years ago, he wrote Firefox on his kitchen table.
When the film rights were bought by Warner's 2 years ago, I mean, I did hear a rumor that they'd bought it on the prompting of Clint Eastwood. And I mean, it was just so ridiculous that it was impossible to believe.
Okay, Jack? We'll drink a cup of it and it'll get you used to it. You're dead, George. Okay.
Want to print that question?
Yep. Okay. Get him up here and we'll dress them all up and do it again. What the hell? Okay. What do you want to do?
It's still a very different world, and it's a very different experience. And I mean, you just do not believe that somebody like Clint Eastwood is going to turn a book of yours into a film.
Craig Thomas had plotted his book using street maps of Moscow. Now he was seeing the real thing. Well, not quite. The Vienna Underground runs until 1 a.m. Then, while the city slept, the art department moved in and turned it into the Moscow subway. Much of it will never be seen in the heat of the chase, but moviegoers have become notoriously vigilant nowadays. Having applied the correct dressing, the director has to keep a firm hold on the content.
Jack, it's all right to look back here.
Yes, it is.
Once you rack back, huh?
I only know something about a film when I read it the first time. I read it the first time and I say, I like this. Then after a certain point in shooting, halfway through, I say, I wonder if this is anything. Nah, maybe it's nothing. Too late. You just got to stay, go back into the paleon cortex of your brain and say, this is the way I felt about it. These are my instincts when I first read it. I'm sticking with those and grinding with it. Otherwise, you'd change it 20 different times.
Achtung, und Bewegung, Action, los! Action!
The English actor, Warren Clark, plays Pavel, a Russian working for British intelligence, who has to guide the bewildered American past the Soviet security guards.
Right now I'm making a movie. I'm treating it like a normal job. There's nothing different about that. But there are times when you sort of, you're standing next to Clint, this might sound really stupid, but there's Clint Eastwood, the fellow that you watched in, you know, five or six spaghetti westerns and when you were a young kid, and then various other films, and you look up to him, and you're standing next to him, and suddenly, my God, it's Clint Eastwood. And then you get back to the business again, you know. The funny thing was, when I met him, we were talking about various things, and I said, I remember when you first came to England, when the Spaghetti Westerns came out, and you did a tour of all the main cities, and this, that, and the other, and he looked at me and said, you must have been a mere child.
You look terrible, Mr. Lewis. I watched your performance. It was not very convincing.
You killed a real Sprague like he's nothing, and then you dump a cover on
him? Hide yourself in the toilets over there. Get yourself together. There'll be more KGB on the way. We will leave the station only when they are confident we have been searched 3 or 4 times. Go.
Your papers are not in order.
They're in order. Look at them again.
No. They are not in order.
Familiar Eastwood scene, and at an end of shooting party, a familiar question to the star from the Viennese press.
Some people complained that in your film is a lot of violence. In the cinema,
has been included in literature and various forms of art since the beginning of time, going back through the Greek tragedies and up through even the Old Testament of the Bible. It's terribly violent stories. They're the first stories we learn as a child, and they're much more violent than any movie I've ever portrayed.
Then Dirty Harry got a chocolate replica of his favorite prop from Austria's Minister of the Interior.
Okay, thank you very much.
He felt lucky today.
It was very enjoyable. It went very fast. The frustrating part of a film like this is the waiting for visual effects. There were so many different ways in which this plane has to fly. And the big difficulty with this particular kind of a film is that all of a sudden you go to a special effects people and you say, now this time we're not out in outer space where nobody knows what it looks like. And we're not out on a black backdrop, so you can, matte lines, et cetera, are all disappear. I want to fly in the clouds and in the planet, and I want to fly over ice and white snow and the Arctic. And everybody's going, oh, my God, there's no way this is going to happen.
It was the task of John Dykstra, who won the special effects Oscar for Star Wars.
And in fact, if you look at the material in Firefox, there's a great similarity to the kinds of things we did in Star Wars. However, the difficulty was multiplied by a factor of 10. That mostly comes down to the problem of making mats. As it turns out, when you make a mat, which is a combination of two pieces of film onto one and make them look like they were shot at the same time, the biggest problem you have is black lines. Well, in space, where everything's black that you're putting behind the ship, that automatically takes care of the problem. And of course, when you put it against the sky, the bit that turns black between the airplane and the sky is really obnoxious.
To get the speeding background for the plane, they had to shoot the Arctic skies with a slow-motion camera.
What we did was we went out and shot at slow frame rates, meaning two frames or one frame a second. But you must remember something. At one frame a second, at the speed we're traveling, 350 miles an hour in the Learjet, we cover, 150 miles in the amount of time that it takes to shoot 10 seconds of film. So in fact, you run out of location very quickly at that rate, see, because the camera's going click, click, and the plane's going, yeah!
Throughout the world, there are a lot of people who may be termed Clint Eastwood fans. Do you have a perception of what it is they want?
No, I think the only thing they expect is they expect to be entertained, and they're willing to accept variations on the entertainment. I was advised by many people not to do Every Which Way But Loose, because that wasn't what my audience expected of me. I said, that's all right, I want to make it anyway. Because there may be some other audience that, or some other elements of the audience, maybe like kids, for instance, who might enjoy that and might reach out and maybe expand the audience, who knows.
Clyde, you still up? What are you doing, pal? Oreo cookie for me. Oh, save mine till later. Buddy.
Mind if I come in?
Not at all.
What was that?
Cookie I was saving till later.
Well, never mind. You can have me instead.
You're looking now. Mm-hmm.
Seem to like that, and I feel that I don't know if they expect any particular type of thing, or they expect maybe a certain kind of action, a certain kind of entertainment, and hopefully they get it. If they're disappointed, then we'll give it to them next time.
I read an interview in the New York Times with you in which you said, because Bronco Billy hadn't done as well as might have been anticipated, you can make fun of anybody, but not yourself.
It was a favorite project of mine. I liked the film. It had there was a certain purity, a certain fighting against the cynicism of our day. There was a certain element of it that I always enjoyed the stories. Maybe it was old-fashioned, maybe too old-fashioned, but it was a good film for me. It received a lot of a lot of attention from a lot of people that maybe didn't like the other films. So you can't do the same thing all the time and just grind to the same. I could have, otherwise I'd be still in Italy doing westerns, like I started out in the 60s. There's a time to move on and try something else.
Pick him up or I'll plug you. I ought to have the whole bunch of you strung up for cattle rustling.
We just wanted to talk to Bronco Billy.
All right, turn around nice and easy. You mean you little pards played hooky from school just to come see me?
Wow, look at his guns. He really is Bronco Billy.
Put your hands down.
Are you really the fastest guy in the West? Wow!
Ain't nobody faster than Bronco Billy. Now look, I don't take kindly the kids playing hooky from school. I think every kid in America ought to go to school, at least up through the eighth grade.
We don't go to school today, Bronco Billy. It's Saturday.
Yeah, well, I've been riding late last night. Man's brain gets kind of fuzzy when he's been on the range.
I don't think I was making fun of myself. I was just, as much as I was just telling the story of one man's dream.
More than many of us, Clint Eastwood has fulfilled his own dream. But he tempers the unreality of being a screen idol with a devotion to work. The initial frisson of becoming famous has long since passed.
In day-to-day life, it isn't fun being well-known. Most actors build their whole careers observing people around them. Then you become a well-known personality, then all of a sudden you become the observed instead of the observer, and that's very difficult.
And having his private life observed by the more sensational press, since he parted from his wife, isn't always pleasant.
The only time it's ever bothered me is when I find that my children become affected by the things people say, and they think other children are asking them, is this true? And everybody says, well, it was written down, it must be true.
And in truth, Eastwood has never been part of the Hollywood side of Hollywood. He's more at home in the cutting room.
Now, where did we put the bag going
up? We had it earlier on in the first spin rather than at this spot. We could cover this with sound.
The rhythm and the cutting, you tighten up and squeeze things and balance out every look as to how long it's going to be. I think the editing is probably where most films are made, but you can't just shoot anything. You have to shoot with a concept, and then editing is where you do the final polish on it. I see the film completed before I start shooting it. It may vary from here. The camera position might be here or here, but basically you have the thing laid out in your mind as to what you're planning on shooting. Otherwise, I'd be guessing around. I might be in trouble. Don't want to paint myself into a corner. It's very easy to do.
What I wanted to ask was, do you get butterflies in your stomach as you watch it with a paying audience for the first time?
Oh, sure, because you never know how a film's going to go. You look at things yourself. You like certain things, and you're always hoping that what you're liking is what they're liking. A paying audience is sitting there, and they're not interested in any of the technical aspects. They're not interested in what you went through to get certain shots. They're only interested in how it affects them. Are they moved by it? Are they suspended by the suspense? Are they nerve-wracked? Are they excited? Are they, if it's a case of a comedy, are they laughing? If they're not laughing, it's not a comedy. And in this particular film, I just never know how it suspends an audience until you see it. It's a few people who've seen it seem to enjoy it okay, but I'll never be satisfied until it's out there and cooking.
And the very business of attending sort of big premieres, is that, can you enjoy it? Is it fun, or is that?
It's fun if it's successful, but I don't know if I'd ever enjoy it. It'd be difficult at the very best. Because you're sitting there, you're watching the film, and your stomach's got to be screwed up like a knot.
Washington, D.C., the site of the world premiere of Firefox. A discreet affair, unlike a Broadway opening, to benefit a military charity. It was organized by the wife of the president's right-hand man, Mrs. Edwin Meese.
Hi,
up in the same town as Clint Eastwood in California.
Well, Ed and I grew up in Oakland,
right.
And so did Clint.
Right.
Did you know him then?
No,
we did not. We met him when the president was governor of California.
Eastwood and his friend, Sondra Locke, are rare visitors to the nation's capital. May not be the sort of gathering he looks forward to, but he carries off this particular role with considerable grace.
Here, Clint. 25 cents apiece, girls.
Put it here, Mr.
All right, get it, Clint.
That's for sure. No way.
Even the sort of people who can afford $1,000 for a charity night out like this drop their reserve when a movie star comes to town.
Nice to see you. Hello, Mr. Eastwood. How are you? Here's Mark right there.
Thank you.
The military is there in force. Admirals, generals, air vice marshals. But Clint is more comfortable with the troops. He once made it to corporal.
Where is he? He must be somewhere.
I used to do this stuff.
Where are you going to have this going?
She's up with Clint Eastwood, yeah. I think maybe I better go up there, too.
There was one just like this that actually flew.
The first time we flew it, it landed in the middle of Wissett Boulevard, accidentally caused a little bit of commotion.
Well, I would think, yeah.
Even the Defense Secretary, Caspar Weinberger, can manage time off from the crises of the world to meet America's number one movie star.
What did they do? Was it a remote control?
Yeah, it was an induction fan.
Yeah.
Right now, it's the star of the evening, a true American, the director, the producer, and the star of Firefox, Clint Eastwood.
Thank you very much. This occasion is so well done and so well produced by Mrs. Meese and Mrs. Weinberger that the fact that they could gather all these beautiful faces in one room here, and I just hope the picture lives up to the occasion. I think the picture sort of speaks for itself, so I'm not going to say too much about it. There's some fabulous visual effects by John Dykstra and his Apogee Corporation. I think. At the end of the film, though, you have to fasten your seat belts because nobody is allowed out of the theater in the last 10 minutes. Okay. Thank you very much.
Coming straight in.